Today, on How We Built It, we take a look at how you can build and run a highly connected global application platform. We go behind the scenes with Finnish gaming company Next Games, and we're going to take a look at their technical architecture that can simultaneously support multiple games and provide core backend services, their platform services architecture using Azure, and the proactive measures they've put in place to prevent gamer fraud. So I'm joined today by Next Games co-founder and CTO Kalle Hiitola. Welcome.
Thanks for having me on Mechanics.
So a lot of folks might be familiar with Walking Dead: No Man's Land, the game that you built. How did you go about architecting that using Azure?
Well, at the end of the day, these are all highly connected applications where the users connect to our backend services with their iOS and Android devices. So let me show you. So when the user connects to our player state service, they are created with a unique ID. That ID is used to retrieve that player state later on when they come back into the game. Mm-hmm. And when we load the player, we put it in memory and keep it there until they end their session. And once the session ends, we store them into our storage, which is in Azure.
And then as you progress through the game as a player, I know that other things start to light up.
Yeah, that's true. So when you get far enough in the game, we can open up your social features of the game, such as guild and chat. And if you want to accelerate your progress within the game, we give you the ability to purchase in-app purchases. And of course, as these kind of modern games needs to be evolving all the time, we need to be able to give the players new content constantly. For example, with the Walking Dead game, we can provide new content right after and each episode has aired.
So when you think about this beyond gaming, you've got some services like content, payment systems, a social platform here, and the statefulness of the app. So this applies beyond just gaming to maybe a line of business app or the next banking app. This is something that anybody can kind of use as a developer, right?
Yeah, that's true. The similar model would work for any of those applications. We have actually used microservices to build our system, and those services run on top of cloud services, which are fully managed virtual machines in Azure. And in addition to those, we have analytics service, which we use to monitor and see what the players are doing within the game. Mm-hmm. And we also have game economics, which we use to change values within the game so we can introduce new content or have a different value for resources, for example.
So all these are broken into microservices and they're using Azure Cloud Services worker roles, but what are some of the other Azure services that you're connecting to via these microservices?
One of the key features that we use is Azure Blob Storage, which we use to save the player state for later on. That's very good for fast file access and scalability. The other one that we use is Azure Table Storage that we use to store the social messages so we can replay them in a certain order. The other very fundamental service that we use is the Cosmos DB that is used for retrieving players with very specific properties, such as locating them by their social IDs like Facebook, Google, or Game Center.
So all these services here are really spanning the entire set of microservices, cloud services, worker roles, Cosmos DB, and storage. Are there things that you're doing that maybe only hit a subset of these microservices?
Yes, there is. We use Azure Event Hub in order to send our analytics events from the player state into our analytics services. And with that, we can actually see how the players are interacting with the game.
So what might you change then if you're monitoring how players are playing the game from your seat in Finland?
Well, for example, we can see if a certain level is too difficult for the players. And actually, in the past, we have removed some of the levels when we saw players trying it to get through those levels over 200 times.
So 200 times is a lot, and you don't want people to get frustrated with the game and then eventually leave the platform. So you got to build that in. But I know there's some other services that you're using that maybe talk to a subset of these microservices as well.
Yeah, we use Notification Hub in order to inform the players when new content is available, like new challenge starting or new events or new campaigns. So for us, it's more like a player retention driver.
So really scalable set of all these different services that you have here, Event Hub, Notification Hub, Cosmos DB, Azure Storage, but you've got a lot of people connecting to the game in real time, a lot of peak traffic. How do you handle all of the demand in terms of users coming in from all over the world?
Well, scalability is one of the basic promises of cloud, and we were building cloud company. So I can show you here our real-time monitoring tool that we actually built on top of Azure. And here you can see those blue dots representing players that are returning back to the game. Mm-hmm. And there's pink dots, which are new players joining the game. And the red dots that are actually players playing against each other. As you can see, we have thousands of players connecting into our backend at any given second.
This is a real-time live view of player activity, but I'm curious how many countries and how many locations are people actually coming in from and what Azure regions are using to manage the game?
Our players span across 166 countries. Mm-hmm. But we drive all that traffic into only one Azure region. But in future, we want to expand that into multiple regions by using Azure Service Fabric.
So how would then you manage traffic in terms of the connections coming in and out of the game itself? Because you've got all these folks coming in all over the world. There's got to be a massive toll in terms of the traffic management side. What are you doing there?
Well, I can actually show you. So when the player is connecting to our backend, we first direct them into Azure Traffic Manager, which is our first level of load balancing. From there, they get picked into one of the cloud services, and that will do a second level of load balancing by selecting a specific instance. And that instance will return the instance-specific address back to the client. And then we use single R to connect into that very specific instance with that address. So in case we get an interruption into the connection, for example, we need to reconnect, we can use that address to get directly back into that very specific instance.
So the client basically has a direct line of connectivity back to the assigned instance in case the signal actually drops or the connection gets lost. But what happens if I'm a developer maybe and I crack open the binaries and start modifying the code because I want to gain status or maybe get more resources while I'm playing the game?
We started our fraud prediction from the one thought that we never trust a client. So I can actually show you. In a case the player has been able to jailbroken or rooted their phone and gain access into our source code, and in that way be able to actually add more resources into their game or get some other advantages. We run the same logic on the client and on the server side in parallel. So whatever you do on the client will also happen on the server side. And the server will then determine if it's just true or false. If it's true, we just let the player to continue with their gameplay. But if it's false, we force the client to reload and get the latest state from the server.
So very creative use of cloud services to keep the clients honest, basically, in terms of the values that they're returning back to the server. But as a big fan of The Walking Dead and a player of the game, I know that you do a lot of work in terms of keeping that in sync with the TV series. What do you do about delivering new content?
Well, as an example, when a new season starts, we can actually get the information, what is going on within that season beforehand, and use that to create new environments and characters and weapons and items that the players can use. And then we load that information into our dashboard, and from there we distribute that to our controller, which is a cloud service, into a different endpoints. In the case of a video content, for example, exclusive content and sneak peeks of upcoming episodes, we use Azure Media Services that can, and from there the client can load the video into their device. In case of a new environment or characters or items that they can use within the game, we load them into CDN and also into our front servers, which are running on multiple cloud services. Client can access them and show the new content for the player.
So a lot of the concepts that we covered today in terms of media delivery, CDN, the front end services, the payments we saw earlier, all of these things are services that you might use across any other type of app beyond games. Any tips for the folks watching in terms of how to architect their apps and their platforms using the cloud?
Definitely. You should start off by doing modern architecture for the cloud. Don't do lift and shift. Secondly, always build for scale. So don't try to get things to work and then try to figure out the scale later. And thirdly, load test a lot. Visual Studio Online has some great load testing tools. You should definitely use them.
So build cloud native, build for scale, make sure that you're load testing. Really great tips, Kalle. You can join the Next Games team and Kalle on the Microsoft Tech community. Details are at the link below. That's all the time we have for today. Thanks for watching.